Good evening. A warm welcome to you all for our third public lecture this fall term. Tonight, we will hear a presentation from one of the leading architects and designers in our Asia region, Lyndon Neri. Lyndon Neri was educated at UC Berkeley for his undergraduate studies and at Harvard Graduate School of Design for his master's in architecture. And it's very nice to see many of his classmates and schoolmates joining us tonight. I have known Lyndon for over 15 years, since he first came to Shanghai around the year 2000 as the project architect with Michael Graves to convert the heritage building now known as Three on the Bund. And after its successful completion, Lyndon moved permanently to Shanghai in 2004 with his wife, Rosanna Hu, to co-found their practice, Neri and Hu Design and Research Office, or NHERO. And both Lyndon and Rosanna have graciously contributed to our School of Architecture in recent years as external reviewers. Today, they have offices in both Shanghai and London. Their work is highly interdisciplinary, ranging from master plans in architecture, to interior design and exhibitions, to product designs and graphics. Their portfolio of commissions is now worldwide, throughout China, as well as here in Hong Kong, I think most recently Aberdeen Street Social at PMQ and others, and in London, Sydney, Kuala Lumpur, Seoul, and in the US. In addition, their work is widely recognized by design awards, exhibitions, and publications. To mention just a few, Designers of the Year from Maison des Objets, Asia, Singapore, Designer of the Year from Wallpaper Magazine in the UK, Interior Design Magazine Hall of Fame in the US, Record Interiors, and Design Vanguard from Architectural Record in the US, AR House Award from Architectural Review in the UK, many others. I mean, to list them all, I think, would require a second lecture from me, but I don't think we have that much time. The important lesson for our students is the example of Lyndon's practice. Now remember the name, Neri and Hu Design and Research Office. So there's reliance on rigorous disciplined research to inform their designs. So in their own words, quote, based on research, Neri and Hu desires to anchor its work on the dynamic interaction of experience, detail, material, form, and light, rather than conforming to a formulaic style. The ultimate significance behind each project comes from how the built forms create meaning through their physical representations. And the point of departure for all their projects is the urban, cultural, and historic context of the city. The title for tonight's lecture is Reflective Nostalgia. Please extend a warm welcome to our guest speaker, Mr. Lyndon Neri.
Thank you, Nelson. It was not because of Nelson. Our practice probably would not be based in Shanghai, so I have a lot to thank him for. And so when he invited me here, I said, I absolutely have to go. Rosanna, this morning, I woke up early in the morning, and Rosanna's like, you're just gonna go to Hong Kong for half a day and be back tomorrow. I'm like, I can't say no to Nelson. So with that, it's gonna be initially boring, okay? So bear with me, since it's gonna be the first 10 minutes. So I'm gonna read a few things to frame the work that we've been doing the last 10 years. But before I show you our projects, I think it's important to understand, in many ways, the very issue that ties all our interests and a lot of the things that we're very concerned with. We call it reflective nostalgia. This is a term coined by Svetlana Boehm, the scholar. Fortunately, she passed away at a very young age, I believe 2.5 years ago. Nostalgia is learned formation of a Greek compound. It's consisting of nostos, meaning homecoming, meaning pain, an ache, wanting to come home. Oftentimes this word is seen in a negative context. But Svetlana Boehm argued that if it's not restorative, that if it doesn't deal with just a fact or tradition and symbols, but rather a reflective one, one that yearns for home, and maybe that yearning takes a little bit longer than one expects, then maybe it's not so bad. So I'm showing you this image by Michael Wolff to the left and to the right, a typical Nongtang space in Shanghai. In recent decades, living and traveling extensively throughout Asia, we observed that alarming trend of Asia's major metropolis, more and more are becoming alike. From Shenzhen to Seoul to Kuala Lumpur or Bangkok, the army of glassy high-rise towers marching through each of their central business districts nearly obliterates any perceivable differences between these cities, which are otherwise culturally unique and highly distinguishable. As the race towards urbanization and densification continues with no end in sight, we cannot help but want to stop and lament, perhaps wax nostalgic feelings on what is being sacrificed in this process. This is an image of Hong Kong, a city that you guys are in. And yet, there are moments in Shanghai that's very similar to that, and in Kuala Lumpur, very similar, especially with that red paint along the background of that slide. Yet it is the image to the right that makes projects come to life, that starts to separate Bangkok from Shanghai, from Shenzhen to Hong Kong. It is these moments that we are interested in. In China, this phenomenon is exacerbated by the sheer scale at which its process of urbanization and modernization has occurred. It is the fastest growing economy in history, and the result is a vast landscape of anonymous cities. The character of what defines a Chinese architecture is in crisis, and for a nation that takes such pride in its history and culture, there is little to show for, at least with regard to recent architectural output. There are certainly iconic moments that have been preserved, those that feature on tourist destinations. But the commercialization of these relics renders them incompetent to represent the depth of Chinese culture, both modern and historic. Any remaining sections of historic urban fabric are constantly under threat. From the Wutong of Beijing to the Nongtang of Shanghai, we believe these are sites full of potential for more engaged architectural design. So Kenneth Frampton, in the book Critical Regionalism, there's a point that certainly resonates within us. The fundamental strategy to mediate the impact of universal civilization with elements derived indirectly from the peculiarities of a particular place. So the question is not if, but how. In our practice, we often examine vernacular typologies such as the Wutong I just mentioned, or the Nongtang that have persisted for centuries and generations. Our research and investigations into these typologies has been a fertile means of critically understanding how to tie our projects into a broader historical context and lineage. The courtyard, for instance, that originated in the northern regions of China, for example, reveals the inseparable relationship between humans and nature. The integration of public and private space, as well as the familial hierarchy which shapes every aspect of Chinese living. And the Nongtang Ali Row houses in Shanghai, for example, that first appeared in Shanghai in the 1850s, still very much alive today, is a fascinating case of study for the blurred boundaries of domesticity and notions of home as well as communal living condition integrated by the permeability and overlapping of spaces. So even as we pay homage to material nature or form, we have no desire to reconstruct the past, to mimic its physicality as cartoon or as diagram. In articulating our attitude towards the issue of preservation versus adaptation, we find Aldo Rossi's seminal text, The Architecture of the City, particularly relevant. He said, it is hardly surprising that this concept of context is espoused and applied by those who pretend to preserve the historical cities by retaining their ancient facades or reconstructing them in such a way as to maintain their silhouette and color and other such things. But what do we find after these operations when they are actually realized? An empty, often repugnant stage. What we are looking for is an alternative reading of these historical typologies, which is not empty, but full of stories. Stories of life, memories, those idiosyncratic fragments that makes us make up our humanity. If you look at this image by Pierre Charot, oftentimes architectural students and even professionals, we love the interior, we love the architecture. Kenneth Frampton says this is the first time in which a building could be perceived as an interior or even a furniture as a whole. And yet not a lot of people, not a lot of students, not a lot of professionals understand in which this building is built. You can't really see this building from the street. You have to go in a courtyard, and within the courtyard, it's an insertion of a historical building. And it occupies the first three floors, and yet the fourth floor and the fifth floor is still maintained. Oftentimes we don't talk about this context. We idealize a particular project. We love the details. We love the object. And oftentimes we take this project and put it within our own project without really understanding the context in which we are in. I was just in Argentina and I drove about 40 minutes to Villa Curochet for the first time, one of my favorite projects from Le Corbusier. And it's interesting the context in which that project is in. And yet I've memorized that floor plan, I've memorized that section, and yet I was stunned when I went in there. Because as a student, I've idealized this space, this amazing project, and yet the power of it is seen when you see it within the context that it's in. So if you look at this duality, nothing against you and Studio, Ben is a good friend. But we constantly navigate between nostalgic feeling towards being, heading towards that old beautiful shoes that we all like, or this modern interpretation of extreme. Where do we find this medium? Where do we practice today? And it is interesting, this tension we are in, the society that we are in. And this doesn't just apply in fashion. This applies in a lot of the art fields that we are in, be it architecture, interior design, or product design. So according to Chris Svetlana Boyne, restorative nostalgia is more literal and direct by comparison. It's a trans-historical reconstruction of the lost home and does not think itself as nostalgia, rather as truth and tradition. A bit harder to pinpoint is reflective nostalgia. It thrives on alga, the longing itself, and delays the homecoming, wistfully, ironically, desperately. Reflective nostalgia does not follow a single plot, but explore ways of inhabiting many places at once and imagining different time zones. It loves details, not symbols. In short, reflective nostalgia offers a critical distance that is less regressive than the former restorative nostalgia. And for that reason, reflective nostalgia is a concept that struck a chord with our own thinking, and in process our own practice. While restorative nostalgia returns and rebuilds once a homeland with paranoia, determination, reflective nostalgia fears return with the same passion. Instead of recreation of the lost home, reflective nostalgia can foster a creative self, that it thrives on contradiction, ambivalence, irony, discomfort, details, fragments, and the present fleeting moment, while denying absolute linear plots and symbol. It is immensely appealing as we try ourselves, often without clear resolution, to make sense of the complexity of the context in which we work. Many of our well-known projects have dealt with historic sites and existing buildings. That's Design Republic, if you have been to Shanghai. That's the retail store that we've completed about 4 years ago. And some have accused us of being nostalgic when we intentionally leave untouched portions of the near ruinous buildings, bringing into question the value of such attachment to the decaying past. But what is unquestionable is that the ruinous condition has the power to move people in an inexplicable way. On some level, we think nostalgia is simply intrinsic to human experience, a universal ailment and collective sentiment. Due to the fast pace of changes we encounter in our environments, with the future uncertain and the present precarious, we predictably look towards the past as a stable time, often imploring to inject some meaningful content to the present. Ruins make us think of the past that could have been and the future that never took place, tantalizing us with utopian dreams of escaping the irreversibility of time. At the same time, the fascination for ruin is not merely intellectual, but also sensual. Ruins gives us a shot of vanishing material. Another crucial aspect of nostalgia, we believe, is the very human attachment to objects. These are pieces by Rachel White Reed, and that's, if you've read the book, you will understand that image. So often it is an object that triggers a wave of nostalgic sentiment, where the object is a tangible stand-in for some other distant time, place, or person. Objects certainly have individual value on some level, but it is their accumulation in relationship to each other upon which we build our dreams and memories. For what is the notion of home, if not a collection of objects? This is where the interdisciplinary nature of our practice becomes crucial. We consider every object, from window, wall, or door, to pendant light, stool, candle holder, or mirror, a reason to call upon not only personal obsessions and memories, but collective traditions and histories. On all scales of design, we embrace nostalgia as productive lens through which we can consider an alternative reading of historical context as a different process of design within that context. So be it architecture, or interior design, or product design, or even graphic design, all of which we practice at the same time. It is important that within that context, the methodology that urges us to look closely at the detail of the mundane in hopes of achieving a deeper understanding of the heritage of those places that we want to not only participate in presently, but to extend to the future. In understanding the richness of life in the old alleyways of Shanghai or courtyard houses of Beijing, we hope to preserve their cultural heritage through the stories they contain within their threadbare walls and amongst the hotspots of its residents' belonging. As the spaces shape their narratives, we consider whether narrative can shape spaces in return, deriving a constructive and meaningful process of space making in our practice. So I'm going to talk about five obsessions today. And these five obsessions, we have a number of them, but these five obsessions keeps coming back between Rosanna and myself and a number of senior associates that practice in our office. These obsessions are obsessions that are important for us to understand the reflective nostalgia that we aspire to have in a lot of the spaces that we are creating. So these are the five obsessions in the last 10 years of our practice. I'm not saying that they will forever be, as our practice starts to become, as we leave China and commission starts to come from foreign shores, our obsession starts to become different, and perhaps it starts to vary. But these are the obsessions, and I'm gonna go one by one later. I'm gonna have about, I was told, an hour and a half, so I'll, some projects, I'm gonna talk a little bit more. I know some people that have worked in my office here. I don't wanna insult you if your project is not here. It's not because the project is not good. These 10 projects I'm showing are not the best projects. They are a representation of a lot of the obsessions that I'm talking about today. So the first obsession, voyeuristic gaze. I think a lot of you are familiar with this particular movie. Rear Window. The film explored a fascination with looking and the attraction of that which is being looked at. The main character is the photographer, whose rear windows look out into a small courtyard and several other apartments. Is the photographer actually in control of the view that he's looking? Or in many ways, he's also being looked at. There are many layers to this particular image. The courtyard, the apartment beyond, and the apartment beyond the apartment. There is an uncanny similarity to conditions we find in Shanghai, where we see a lot of hidden secrets on the street. In the Nongtang, I was telling you. In fact, the Nongtang life is what defines, for many people, the real urban fabric of home life in Shanghai. If you look at this image by Helmut Newton, like the child who wanted to see his parents' room in Louis Bourgeois' beautiful red room image, we adults have desire to see what we like. See beyond the surface, beneath the dress, like this image by Helmut Newton, showing the voyeuristic gaze that is in all of us. I'm sure a lot of you wants to know what Donald is thinking right now. Okay, I'm not gonna bring politics into the lecture. The first two projects I'm gonna talk about will be dealing with these voyeuristic obsessions that we have. So a few years ago, a client from Hong Kong actually came to us who wanted his secrets exposed. I quote verbatim, "I want my secrets exposed." Very strange briefing from a client. He came to me and he said he had a dilapidated house. And it's in one of those Nongtang down this street in Tianzifang. And his brief was very simple. "I have two other friends. I come to Shanghai once a month. I'm tired of going to different hotels. I love the hotel that you've designed, Lyndon, but I want to have a place for my own home that I can call home. But at the same time, I want my secrets exposed." When a client tells you that, I don't ask more questions. All I did was, how many bedrooms do you want? How many public space you need? And that was it. But what was interesting was, it was one of those typical lane houses that was dilapidated. And we took this opportunity to explore the possibility of perhaps showcasing the sectional quality of this particular typology that's have been long lost in this city. So if you guys are from Shanghai, some of you probably are, you know this context in which a split house is seen, and at the back, those are usually either scholars or guests that lives, and the main halls are the big rooms in front. A lot of them have been demolished, unfortunately. The ones that remain have no understanding of the sectional quality and the beauty of these houses. And so this is, it's a little blurry. So what we did was very simple. The facade has been renovated and restored to a point where it was not recognizable. So the first thing we did was we completely stripped the facade so that way you can completely see the depth of the building from afar. And in many ways, from the inside, you can actually see the lane houses outside. And in many ways, the lane houses is brought in to your living spaces. We inserted this new metal stairway that leads you up. And that's the sort of axon, very simple floor plan. And if you look at the floor plan, rather simple and straightforward. So the thing that we touched was just a stairway to insert the front facade and the back facade and the toilet right in the middle, the core of it. So the first time we presented this, the client goes, very interesting, but what's so special about this? Of course, I continued and I just presented. I said, wait till you understand a section of this, then maybe you'll appreciate what we're about to do. So sectionally, you have to remember all these lane houses used to have the same facade, but by the time we entered this, there were maybe 15 different facades, so I can't really tell which one was historical. So the first thing we did was we did a section cut to it so you actually understand the sectional quality and the depth of all these lane houses. And so what we did was we insert the most public component of the project, which is a stair that leads you from the first floor to the third floor. I'm going to show you. To the most private space of the house, which is the toilet. Of course, I have a curtain there. But then the client came in and goes, oh, I see, this is the most secret. The secret aspect that you had wanted to give me. So this is his two friends living with him, and he really loved it because he made it a party house for 2 months. Unfortunately, he passed away after 2 months. He was crazy. He jumped in the Huangpu River with an infected knee, and I found out because his wife came to my office a month later, gave me a letter that he had written me, and said how satisfied he was. The wife saw this letter in his place, and asked me, what was my husband's brief for you on this house? What are you gonna tell a wife that does not know anything about the briefing that the husband made? So I said, I think he wanted to surprise you, and this project was not quite done yet. So she was happy. But sometimes as architects, you have to twist the truth. But the idea behind this is to actually bring sort of the outside in. And so appreciating the lane houses within Shanghai, that in itself become framing of the artwork and bringing those beautiful images into the house. So there you go. The most private space connected to the most public spaces with two of his friends in the city. So by doing this, actually the notion of the split is completely seen from every angle, from the living room, from the bathroom, from the private room. You're constantly confronted with this section. The second project, I have a video. It's about 13 minutes long, so I'm gonna let it run so I can rest, okay? I did film this, so I'm just gonna jump this. This is a house under construction right now, but I'm not gonna explain. I'm gonna let my film talk for itself. Oh, we missed the first half of it, so okay, I guess didn't miss much. Thank you. sorry. There's supposed to be a reading of these, but if you guys don't mind, from a distance, if you can read, that'd probably be easier. But actually, there's something wrong with the film because there's an accompanying. I was actually going to bring Rosanna into this picture because she reads part of this as I read part of it. So since there's no narration, I'm gonna try. The idea behind the house here, when we were approached by the client, He had built a fortune by making industrial roof for the last 10 years in the outskirts of Shanghai. Starting from about a year ago, he needed to bring scholars into his manufacturing plant, and also understanding the question of industrialization in agricultural land in the outskirts of Shanghai. In many ways, he was guilty. In many ways, he also wanted to find a solution to explore other options in which how to deal with the urbanization of even remote villages like his. So he invited 12 architects to come and do houses, small houses, retreat, commercial spaces like cafe, community centers, to explore issues and ideas of domesticity. And so we were given this commission of a small house, and so we took advantage of trying to explore this duality of a house for an introvert and a house for an extrovert. But by having this center pool that you can't enter, you can see, you can experience, but you can't really enter. This is that big landscape that divides both spaces. It is only in section that you start to see the difference, the different quality of both the space that's more open, the space that's enclosed. I'm sorry, this is the first time I'm watching this film without narration, so I'm also stunned just as much as you guys are, but try to enjoy the movie. It was also a complex project, because you can imagine 12 other architects trying to outdo one another. So we tried to do as quiet as possible. If I only show you that 12 other scheme, which were all shown in the Biennale, you'll understand what I'm talking about. We're next to Su Fujimoto and Vo Trang from Vietnam, so you can imagine what they look like. All very interesting. So instead, we created this fortress in a very silent way, start to explore spaces of these two extreme characters. Thank you for your patience. This is the second obsession I want to talk about is blurring boundaries. This particular artwork, it's called Plan 10. I think some of you probably are very familiar with a fairly famous photograph from the series Plan in 2003. The artist is Aneta Griskowska and John Smaga. Series of photos documenting the interiors of 10 apartments in Warsaw. Unique photographic technique used in which the overall picture of the room seems scanned by stitching together an aggregate of aerial photographs. Very much like Google Earth, except in many ways one can say it's not accurate, or one, it is. This particular image is striking in that the image is cropped at the supposedly fenced property line, so we can see the house as a room in the extended field of the landscape. It's pretty amazing what happens when you try to blur the boundaries of sight lines or between inside and outside spaces. And you can sort of see these images, they're all different, yet they're seen like as if it's a house. And yet the landscape, the inside, have images of grass and soil, and the outside have moments wherein the furniture extends out, you see remnants of walls seen in the field. So there's really a blurring of whether you're inside or you're outside. This is a particular house in Singapore, in the Botanical Garden, if you know. The client came to us. I'm going to show you this drawing because this is a really bad line drawing, but I always show this. So students, please don't follow me. There was a purpose why we did this drawing. We were approached by a Chinese diaspora. Chinese, they're everywhere, and they think the same. So just because they're in Singapore or Indonesia or the Philippines, they think like Chinese. What do you mean by that? They like their houses to be as big as possible. So oftentimes, they don't really care about FAR, floor area ratio. So what I didn't know about this project was when we came in, we were the third architect. This particular client have already fired two other architects, and prominent ones as well. So had I known, I'd probably not take this commission. So we went to this presentation, and the local associate architect told me, Lyndon, you gotta make it as big as possible. I said, there is a requirement. We can only make it as, because don't show that axon right there, because then you're gonna get fired immediately. No such thing as bar building. So we did this line drawing. I didn't have the tree. I made it all one line drawing and read like a box. So the father, the patriarch of this project, this family, came in, look at the building, and goes, wow, how come this project is so huge? How come this house is very big? You're a really good architect. It's amazing how we're judged with the idea of volume. And so what I did was, I start talking about landscape. Halfway through, I realized that that was not the right way to explain it. So I start talking about how big this project was. It is big, it's about 2,400, but he had wanted 5,000. So it does look like 5,000, three stories high. And so I was hired. But what happened was, it is actually this. So in many ways, it's a courtyard. There's these two bars that comes together. And what was interesting was that sectionally, what we did was, because it's a botanical garden and you actually see the sight line, we made the public space all transparent. And so all the public spaces, because there's three generations of family that actually can be connected to one another, and up above is the more private aspect of the living, and down below are the back of house and guests and all the other miscellaneous spaces. So here it is. I've always liked this rendering. It's kind of, I know from students' perspective, it's probably not very nice, not very hip, but I like it just because, you know, this the extent of computer rendering I can do. But the idea is this whole landscape, you sort of see this transparency. At least I did, I tried, okay? This was 8 years ago. I could do a better job now, I think. But the idea of this more private space that is floating and the public space being this blurred public and private space. And so here it is. Oh, that's really blurry. That's not my intention. I didn't see that image when my person preparing this lecture, but obviously I didn't see that. I didn't show that model to the client. So sometimes you don't show everything to your client. Okay, just for your office, maybe for exploration. And this is the construction photos of the project. Since it's owned by a pretty prominent family in Singapore, we couldn't go in after construction. So this is the construction photo, unfortunately. This is the image of this public space being very open and transparent. And you can sort of see the landscape. By now, all the greens have grown. So literally, when you go into this house, you're within this verdant landscape. And in many ways, you're enclosed, very much part of the forest. That's here. So these are the images with the construction photos. Too bad we didn't get a chance to photograph the interior, which we also did. But with all rich clients, you know, you're not supposed to do that. So here it is. We've opened all the bedrooms. Don't have your typical one door. Actually, I should show you the image here. So this is your typical double corridor. So all the bedrooms are lined up. The doors have five different ways of opening. These are all doors, so you could open it up. So cousins from one end of the bar can actually talk to the other cousins on the other end of the bar. So you could open this so it's like a treehouse. So the only thing that is private are the bathroom in between. And they don't have windows except skylight from above. However, the bedrooms, obviously when you open up, you'll have balconies, both the balcony or a walkway. And these are some of the images. This is a competition in Kuala Lumpur that we recently won. I'm gonna talk quickly about this project because there's other project I wanna spend more time on. This is in the central area in Kuala Lumpur. This is where all the train tracks are. This existing building was the only remaining British building that was, there's three left in this particular area. And they were built during the time when the Malaya Railway was being built. And so this building was very important because the British were planning all the railway tracks from Kuala Lumpur when Singapore was still part of Malaysia. Obviously, the idea was to connect this railway all the way to the inner parts of Malaysia. And so these were the three prominent buildings. One of them is now going to be converted into a museum for contemporary art. And so when the government sector and a private institution contacted us, there were three of us, the final three. The idea was this was the remnant that was given to us. And we were supposed to come up with a solution to insert a new concept. And I'm not going to tell you who the other competitor, because it's not professionally right to do that, but I'll tell you, by telling you what they did, you probably can tell who they are. One of the other schemes just completely covered up brick building with this sort of acrobatic sort of roof on top of the building, and the other one literally left it open and dig underground three stories. And so what we did was we actually inserted these objects, these remnants that were very much part, this insertion that were very much part of the railway station, the depot that was all over. So we took remnants of these and actually inserted within the space. But keeping in mind that the existing building, this brick building, will still be seen experientially once you go in. So you could sort of see the insertion, but it's not so much the plan that's relevant in this project, it is the perspective spaces that I will show you. So within this particular space, you will see the old and new, the blurring of the old and new, clearly delineated with our insertion and showing very clearly what preserving the historical building, this two historical building, and have our insertion tied into this space. The third obsession I want to talk about is objecthood. This is by Rachel White Reed. I'm going to focus on the one to the left, that concrete structure. It is perhaps her best known work. It was a concrete cast of the inside of an entire Victorian terrace house completed in autumn 1993 and exhibited at the location of the original house in East London, where all the houses in the street had earlier been knocked down by the council. Themes of absence and memory are embodied in her interpretation of the everyday domestic objects and their overlooked negative spaces. The interior of a closet, the section of a floor, or the hollow of a chair, an exploration of the artist's innovation use of the unseen areas that complement an object's identity suggests to us the deconstruction of comfort, home, and memory. So our idea of our interest in objecthood is not necessarily the building itself as a form, but in many ways the remnants or the relief per se, just like Rachel White Reed has done here. The moments, perhaps the poche, the occupying of the poche, the spaces that are not necessarily the figure in itself. This is a project in Korea, Seoul. We were approached by this cosmetic brand called Sowasu. I think some of you probably know this brand very well. Well, it came to our office, I didn't really know this brand. And so a lot of our senior guys said, no, not interested in this cosmetic retail stuff. And I looked at it and I'm like, no, I'm not interested either. Then Rosanna walked in last minute. Rosanna goes, are you guys crazy? If I'm gonna get free Sowasu cream for the rest of my life, I'm gonna take this project. So that was very interesting. I'm glad we took this project because the client was quite a visionary. And it was in the Gangnam area. If you know Seoul, it's probably the most, it's like in Japan, in Tokyo, it's where Aoyama area, very similar. Or at least they try to be. And these are all the flagship building. And during our first meeting, that's when I realized the pressure was more serious than I had thought. I walked in and the client said, you know, I have a museum designed by Alvaro Sisom. My main headquarters designed by David Chipperfield, and my house is also designed by David Chipperfield, and next it's you. So I'm like, oh, I was glad that I took this project, but at the same time, I was kind of nervous. What made it worse was the fact that there was this existing building, and this building was designed by Eroji. I'm not saying worse that Eroji is a bad architect, he's a great architect. But we were to occupy this building, and he said, it's up to you to either demolish this building or keep this building. It's up to you. So, you know, as students, when I was a student, I would probably say, yeah, let's demolish, you know, this whole thing. But I had to think hard. It's not just because it's Eroji, but I had to also think about what we believe in as a practice. And just because this was built 20 years ago and not had a cool building that was built in 50 years ago, that doesn't mean that this does not merit to be preserved. So we took the stand, we had three options, and one option was to demolish it, but two other options was actually to insert this thing. So we talked about objecthood, the reverse objecthood. So what we did was we inserted this lantern-like structure into this existing building. And it was in this particular space, the lantern in itself is not just the object, but actually the inner structure of this lantern became the space that we carved. And so you can sort of see what we did was we took this bronze metal and inserted them in, and they're all over the space. And in many ways, they form the walls, the ceiling, and at the same time, they also represent, they also became the idea of where it hold on to the lights and display cases, and it starts to form the space, both inside and outside. So you could kind of see this. Including the outside, that's still under construction, so now it's really like a bird's nest all throughout. But you can sort of see what we're trying to do. We've carved through the project here. There's a film next to this. I hope there's music. Treatment rooms down below. So you see the sexual quality of the space. These are moments from the first floor, you actually see the third floor. And vice versa, from the fourth to the third, there's a lot of sectional cut. But it's not so apparent because of all these, the web of grid that goes throughout, so you see a glimpse of it. So very much like Rachel White Reed, a bit different. What she did was visually showing you these remnants, these spaces that are considered back of house or considered leftover. What we're trying to do was occupying those spaces that are often not glorified. Distance, because this becomes a symbol. It's both a lantern, but at the same time, it's not just object. From a distance, it seems like it's an object. But what was interesting is from a distance, even though it's an object, by the time you come in, the object sort of dematerializes because you're actually experiencing the space in itself. I didn't know this continues. I hope it doesn't. Okay, I'm gonna quickly We only have about 15 minutes left, right? Is that right? So I'm going to quickly go through. This is the project we won in London, so this is probably the oldest police station in London. And if you know London, it's in Covent Garden. It's across from the Opera House. And 16 firms were shortlisted. We didn't think we had a chance of winning. So we proposed a very crazy scheme by having floating bricks throughout the whole space. 16 firms went to six went to two, and we won. So now we actually have to build it. And I actually don't know how to build it. So this is the historical part of the project. And this is an interesting project because what we did was Oscar Wilde was in prison here. Casanova was in prison here. It's a police, it's both an oldest courthouse and used to be a police station. And they used to call themselves Bow Street Runners. And so when we were given this commission, we thought, you know what, we should not demolish the 16 cells underneath. All the other practice, maybe with the exception of two other firms, decided to keep cells. And we thought by keeping the cells, you know, it could become bedrooms without window, you know, it could be cheaper. And we thought there's no way the client would go for this. So we thought this would be more interesting as a proposal. So these are cells we kept underneath. And we were also asked to do a museum, so we made this police museum. This was required. And what we did was we actually opened different holes into the older building. So from the jail cell, you actually see the activities of the museum. So here are the remnants. Sorry, these are just some of the images. So it looks rather simple, but this is all wrapped. And I'll show you the perspective here. So this is all wrapped in this floating brick because this is in Mayfair. And by virtue, you have to use brick. And everyone complained, all the contestants, and we decided, you know what, why don't we just float all these bricks? And they loved it. Even the city councilor says, wow, this is amazing. Now that all the engineers were working with OVR to make this happen. And all the mock-ups that come in are so heavy. And so we're trying to make it really light, but you know, we just had a breakthrough 3 months ago. So this could be quite interesting. So you can imagine the room with all the shadows coming in, different patterns to this space. So here it is completely wrapped in this floating brick. I'm gonna go through this rather quickly because the fourth obsession is rebranding history. And this is an image by Andres Geffeler. They are based on images of urban areas, revealing both views of public sites and their surfaces, as well as offering insight into close areas from a bird's eye perspective. By means of an elaborate photographic technique, Geffeler creates these possible and impossible viewpoints. Hundreds of individual shots are digitally joined, giving rise to the impression that the overall site has originated from a much higher perspective. So you see the view thinking it is a whole, but it is actually a stitching of different smaller spy satellite-like imagery. Why is this important to us? We're given a lot of projects with historical significance, some of which we don't really know how to surgically repair them because they have, over the last 50, 60 years, have changed hands many times. And there are different interpretations, different insertions, different renovations, and during the Cultural Revolution, obviously, different peoples have inhabited a lot of the public spaces and created their own little design. So, you know, Shanghai is known for spaces without architects. So that in itself is very interesting. So the key here is this interpretation and the stitching and how in different smaller parts we can make up a new whole. So in exhibiting cultural texture, that's what we know how we can employ this method, adding a set of judgment of what to keep and what to change, a mix of new and old to breathe new life into an old building. So when we were given this commission, by actually the Shanghai, one of the municipal district it was interesting because the government came to us and said, Lyndon and Rosanna, would you be interested in this particular building? And we thought it would be interesting for us to create a platform for design. Rosanna and I also started an initiative called Design Republic, which is a retail platform, or we use retail as a guise to get investors to come in and invest in our project. But really, it is a showcase to bring, in many ways, design to the forefront of the everyday in Shanghai. Because oftentimes, if you go to Milan with a Chinese badge, people often say, well, you're from China, you're gonna just copy us. So they won't let you enter your booth. So it's really frustrating. And so what we did was, we thought by creating this platform in the city that we are practicing, raising the design consciousness, in many ways bring the best of design from the world to China. So hopefully one day we can bring perhaps some of the best work of China back to the world, or Asia for that matter. We needed a platform, we needed the space, so we've been talking to the district mayor to give us a space. And initially they gave us so many buildings, they were not that interesting because oftentimes they were this gleaming tower that they thought was considered hip in their mindset. And this was given to us after I actually begged them. This building, unfortunately, was already bound to be demolished. Actually, not demolished. The facade was supposed to be kept. And the developer wanted two towers behind this facade. So if you can imagine, this facade kept, and then two buildings built behind it. So when I saw this building, I went to the district mayor and I said, this is actually what I want. And he said, if you could give me programs, you can design this building for me, then I will build this for you at our cost. So that was very exciting for me and Rosanna. So what we did was, I want to show you the image. This was in the English concession, and you could see the left side. I know a lot of people think we have this fascination for a police station. That's just by chance, guys. So this is the English concession. It was dilapidated by the time we got it. And so what we did was, we stitched this building back together, piece by piece. And obviously, that front part of it was illegal. In Chinese, we call it wei zhang jian zu, meaning illegal structure. But since the district mayor was our landlord, he said, please don't demolish this, I love him. He says, because if you demolish that illegal structure, then I've lost my square footage of the whole building, you know? So talk about hypocrite, I can't tell him that. But he's our biggest supporter. So we did this project, so you can see the left and the right. Sometimes it's not necessarily about inserting, so it's just about taking moments of it so you actually see the sectional quality of the space. It's simple gestures like this. Understanding the different layers, keeping the old, inserting new. Again, this is the entry, opening the space. So there's actually a gradation between lower spaces and heightened spaces. And you see moments of this. So sectional quality, again, the layers of the old brick and the new insertion. This is now a building, not just a retail store for furniture. There's a restaurant in there, a Michelin, actually, star restaurant in there. There's also a one-bedroom hotel. There is a little gallery. We call it Manifesto Gallery. There's also talks that's held there, a lot of lectures. Every year, there's about 8 lectures. And that was part of our agreement with the government. We had to bring all these programs into the space in return for a low rent and for them to support us in sort of building this. So here it is, some of the spaces. So it's about stitching these spaces together. I have a movie here. I think it'll give you a better idea. And there are moments with lath construction, we actually kept it here. It's not as empty now, obviously, with a lot of furniture. It's actually quite beautiful. Then you can actually see sort of how the constructions were made. There are moments where we actually strip the construction and left what it was before for people to understand sort of how these were built in the past. This is a one-bedroom hotel. You guys probably saw this in New York Times. It says average room rate is about $8,000, which was wrong, but if someone's foolish enough to rent it, I'd be happy to take them. It's actually renting the whole space as a commercial entity. So these are the project images. I'm gonna jump to the film. Sorry, the file is so big, so I'm struggling to move forward the images. This is the restaurant. Okay. Saw the images. I'm gonna skip this project, okay guys, because we only have about, I have about 10 minutes here. So I'm gonna skip this project. I'm gonna go to the fifth and last obsessions. I think that's, the fifth obsession is exhibiting cultural texture. And I think this is pretty self-explanatory. I think probably a lot of you are familiar with Robert van der Hulst, a Dutch photographer. From the series Chinese Interiors. The work is very self-explanatory. It shows how culture can be layers and layers of texture, and seen through different eyes, often it shows a different side of itself. And oftentimes, it takes a foreign eye to come in and see some of these images that we take for granted. The everyday, the mundane and the ordinary things that we sort of take for granted. Even in Hong Kong, I'm here and I'm all always inspired by this city. And yet I think a lot of you probably, if you've been here for a long time, you probably take it for granted. So these sort of particular obsession also applies to a lot of our project. I'm gonna, this is called Putong Museum, not Putong, sorry, that's a typo. This is a competition that we recently, we were invited, we actually invited, there were about 15 practices, and it's the last six, and we were just informed we didn't make it to the last two. So it's a morning. Today is actually, I just found out yesterday, so I'm showing this to you as a way of perhaps morning moment. So the last six was Atelier Des House, Open Architecture, Sejima, David Chipperfield, and Jean Novel. I think it's between Jean Novel now and David Chipperfield. But in any case, let me show you the film directly. Okay. Since we don't have time, I'm just going to show you the film. Thank you.
do. There's two other projects. One last architectural project, and I'll show you a small product design project for those of you that are interested in product design. This is a project that most of you are probably familiar with. We call it the Vertical Lane House. I love this quote by Calvino. Arriving at each new city, the traveler finds again a past of his that he did not know he had. The foreignness of what you no longer are or no longer possess lies in wait for you in foreign, unpossessed places. I think that's pretty self-explanatory. I think it oftentimes, there are certain things in a foreign land that actually you feel very much at home with. And they are waiting for you in foreign places, and it's interesting. So when we were given this project, initially the client called us and said it's a project on the bun, so I was very excited. I thought it was that bun right there, but it's actually south of the bun. So south of the bun, there's really nothing except for a lot of warehouses, old warehouses. And what they did was they wanted to demolish this warehouse, and we thought that was not ideal. He wanted us to do a brick building. He called it, let's build it like old London. And I thought that was very strange. So I said, would you consider exploring the idea of, he wanted to do a hotel. I said, why don't you explore the idea of all these different scenes, the street scenes in Shanghai. And he thought, you're crazy. Why would you want to explore all this? You know, a lot of Chinese, when they become rich, and wealthy, obviously, they don't like to see this perhaps past that they consider poor or unsanitary. And I always find it amusing if you're in Paris and you're in Rue de Bac and you're in a cafe, it's kind of romantic to be on the sidewalk. And yet when you're in Shanghai, it's called unsanitary. I always find that baffling. So what we thought was, by celebrating a lot of the everyday, people brushing their teeth, and yet this is still very much relevant in Shanghai. These images, even to this day, you know, they used to have fake products and now they have real products, but they still hang their products because that's just the way of life, how they live. And you see sectionally in terms of spaces when you go in, there are moments that you actually see rooms beyond living room, dining rooms, even bathrooms. So if you look at the lane houses are the most exciting alleyways in Shanghai, because when you walk, there are glimpses of the city that makes it kind of interesting. And obviously, there are times you don't want to see things. I live in an old house in the French Concession, and what we did was, our toilet, we had this full height mirror open, and 3 meters away is my neighbor's kitchen. And so sometimes when I'm tired and I'm jet lag, I come in and I turn on the light, and I'm half naked. And I have to pretend that that was always the case, you see, because there's always this tension between me and my neighbor. And there's always that relationship, and it's interesting. So it's a real condition that we live in the city. And so we thought, why not take this idea into the hotel that we're designing? Why not deal with a traveler as opposed to a tourist? A tourist comes to a city and have a checklist of the places that they want to see. And they come to Shanghai and they see the Huangpu River, they see the three tall towers, and they see Xintiandi, and they go, we've seen Shanghai, let's go home. But I don't think that's the real Shanghai, or at least that's just a part of Shanghai. The essence of Shanghai is the alleyway, you know, the street life, many of the essence that you don't experience. You know, it's like going to a museum. People often go to a museum, the first thing they do is they do a rapid purview of the artwork, immediately go to the bookstore and buy the monograph of the artist without really, it's baffling to me, but that happens. And so what we did was, we said, why don't we create a hotel for a traveler as opposed to a tourist? Well, the client really couldn't care less about our conceptual framework. It was just make it cool, and it doesn't matter what it is. So the first thing was, he wanted to demolish this, and we said, why don't we keep it? Because if you want to make it like the London docks. He showed me a lot of brick building in London, and he says, make it look just like this. And I said, if you want to do this, you know, I don't think you should hire us. And so I was surprised that he actually agreed to us, but I think partially it's because I said this was going to be a cheaper proposition. So he agreed to it. So here it is, the project. We have 19 rooms. What was interesting is not so much the plan, but the section of these particular rooms. Because in the section, so that's Waterhouse, we created an addition on top with cord and steel. And in this project, we dealt with the old and the new, the idea of public and private, obviously. And so you sort of see, we kept the lobby as it is, just reinforced it structurally to keep the very fabric of this building. And you see these ramps, because there were three buildings, so we had to tie it together in terms of circulation. And he had a big collection of furniture that we had to use. So some of the chairs, some of the furniture are just in the corridor that does not do anything, but that's part of his collection. We had to kind of display it. And so that bedroom is the cheapest because it looks down into the reception. It also happens to be the smallest room. So here, see the old and new. So this is the framing, and so you see. And another problem we are facing in Shanghai is that some of these projects or some of these rooms were designed so you actually see the alleyway of the context beyond or next to it. But by the time we finished building this hotel, all the contexts were demolished. So that's another issue that we have to deal with in Asia. Sort of the context we understand it to be always just kind of disappeared after our project. So it's no longer the context that we were working with. And so we did sectional qualities, but if you do want to come to this hotel, do tell me. There are 19 rooms. Only two rooms have complete privacy. The rest is completely at your own risk. But in many ways, this is very much life in Shanghai, lane houses in Shanghai. So you see moments of, a lot of my friend goes in and says, you should have told me because I was butt naked and people could see me and I had to. So you see these images and you think they are manipulated, they're not, they're real. So a lot of glasses, a lot of them, you actually see the outside part of it is inside. And so sectionally, that's the restaurant down below. There's a section cut to it, three of them. So you actually look up and be able to see the bedroom, and from the bedroom you can look down. And we also kept all the bridges. This was a warehouse for the Japanese retail magnate, and he actually kept a lot of opium in this particular warehouse. So he needed four or five different stairs to lead to different places and different storages. So we actually kept it, all these different meandering stairs. Some of them led to nowhere. But that in itself was a beautiful artwork. That's not a mirror, that's another room. Yeah. So I like this as a parent because when my kid travels with me, I love extending rooms like this when I can completely see them. And that white part, you actually look down into the restaurant. Okay. So there's that relationship. And in the restaurant, one side is the street, and the other side is the courtyard. So this restaurant is literally floating between public and private. It's interesting because if you're dining, some people literally walked past you and look at what you're eating. So this is the space that you look up to. There are three of this, and many more. And these wood were recycled from the ceiling above, the roof that was already dilapidated, and so we kept it. And some of the back rooms and balconies, what we did was we actually have high-gloss stainless steel, so these louvers actually can be turned, so you actually can see the garden below. So these are construction photos. This was construction photos. I want to show you a film. And I hope this time... Oh, no. Thank you.
music is by my oldest son. You can see I'm not his kid. Show you one last slide, film, because this practice is Neri and Hu, and so I want to try to bring, so I was trying to find a film where both Rosanna and myself are in, so here it is, and I just thought that it would be important for her to be part of this.
Jaguar was the sponsor designers, obviously. We had to do something that somewhat relate to the context where we practice. So we thought, what would be something similar to a picnic basket in the Chinese context? So we thought of Lyndon, which is a lunchbox. It's interesting because we were trying to also create an object that would be incorporated into Jaguar. And since the interior of Jaguar is already so perfect, we thought a picnic basket would be a great addition. From a tea set to a candle holder to a necklace to a wooden plate, things that are very Chinese in many ways.
There's a lot of thinking behind, you know, how the inside of the box is related to the outside. There are these openings of lines that allow you to see through to the interior of the box. So there's a lot of architectural qualities to this piece.
I think this is one piece that allowed us as architects to explore the spatial quality of an object in sort of a sectional form, but at the same time, the blurriness of public and private is also seen through this piece. So when you're carrying this piece outside, in many ways people can see a glimpse of what you're carrying, you know, what you're going to actually need that day, or what that kind of celebration is.
Thank you.